Go ahead, Tony.
Hey, I'm glad to be here. I'm intimidated as hell with the level and number of football coaches on here, but I'll let it rip. I'm going to talk about Feed the Cats as something that that started out as a track sprint program that is now kind of bled into the football world. And I'm very proud of it. There's dozens of high schools that are doing it and a few colleges. And the whole thing about Feed the Cats started in 1999. Basically, I wanted to get the best athletes out for track. And I was having a hard time doing it, even though we were fairly successful. But basically, I had to admit, first of all, that track sucked. And then I had to attract cats to my program. And by cats, I'm talking about fast twitch athletes. And what I've learned about cats, or the true cats of the world, love to compete. They're your best competitors. They're people that you really need if you're going to win in a high-performance sport. But cats hate to run. So I basically did away with running at track practice. All we do is sprint, jump, and recover. A very essentialist plan. Now, in football, I think this is from The Art of War. I think there's three ways to win war, and that's through power, speed, and misdirection. And I think the typical football program does two of these three things well. They covet the third thing, speed, but they do nothing to maintain or improve speed. And that's really where I'm going with my talk today, is that misdirection is what all you guys were talking about for the last half hour, all the scheming and placement and pass routes and blah, blah, blah. Power, of course, is the weight room, the church of football. Speed is something that everybody wants, and then they don't do anything about it. One of the problems is you have Neanderthals like this running the football world, and there is no way this guy ever won a race in his life. Now, sure, Oregon's still going to be fast, but they're fast because they recruit speed. This guy does absolutely nothing to improve or maintain it. This guy plays for the Philadelphia Eagles. He ran the hurdles for my son, Alec, down at Edwardsville High School. And he played at Minnesota for a couple years and then at SIU. But he came back this spring and was talking to one of Alex's track athletes, and he had some advice for him. He said, first of all, the best advice that I can give you is don't let them take away your speed. As soon as you get there, they're going to try to pack on the weight and make you live in the weight room. And that's what he did. And this is really sad. Here, an NFL defensive back, and he says, I have never been as fast as I was in high school. I think this is an indictment of all football, high school, college, professional, that we take kids that are really fast, we recruit them, and then we do nothing about it. Once in a while, you'll see something like this. Minnesota State does not produce NFL players, but they had a good receiver one time who said that the only way he was going to get noticed is if he worked on nothing but speed until he could run a 4.45. He did, and the rest is history. So how do you train a cat? You got to sprint as fast as possible. Let me stop it right there. Sprinting is when you're spiked up, you're getting timed, you're recording the time, you're ranking the time, and you're publishing the time. If you're not doing those five things, then you're just running. Sprinting must have all five of those factors. People say, well, why would we get like track spikes on? We don't play on a track. Well, you want to be as fast as you can possibly be in your sprint training. As often as possible for highly skilled athletes, that's 3 days a week. As fresh as possible, that means you can only train sprinting and speed when you are fresh. There's only three surefire ways to increase speed. That is sprint mechanics, max speed sprinting, and jumping. The thing that's obviously missing there is the weight room. Everybody that lives in a weight room wants to tell me how cleans and snatches make you faster. And there's nothing in the weight room that I could go in and say, give me your four best whatevers, and they're going to be on my 4x1. If I did that, we'd be last place in the state every year. There is no lift that directly coincides or is a KPI for speed. In Southern Illinois, we used to say, you don't plant beans and grow corn. I'm not saying that you shouldn't lift. you know, God knows all football players have to lift, body armor, collision sport, all those things. But anybody who thinks that this guy is going to get fast by doing what he's doing is flat 100% wrong. Another thing that in a Feed the Cats program that's really, really hard for football coaches to grasp, and that is you need to stop doing mindless conditioning. If you want to know more about this, I wrote an article that is, I believe is the number one article on the Track Football Consortium page. Just type in mindless conditioning, Tony Holler, you'll find it. But anyway, all seven of my football articles are linked at the bottom of this article. So why should you not condition? Well, first of all, it makes you tired, and tired is the enemy of speed. Secondly, conditioning makes you slow. You have to remember that fast players are fast in the fourth quarter. If I run a 4.5 and you run a 4.8, there's no amount of conditioning that's going to make you faster than me in the fourth quarter, period. Speed reserve, that means the faster my max speed, the faster my submax. So I can be tired and still beat your ass because I'm faster than you are. Alactic specificity. When you train for speed, you are training for 5-second reps with about a 30-second rest. And when you do that, you are being very specific to the sport of football. A high school football player, or maybe even a college football player that plays one way, plays 5 minutes of football in a game. 5 minutes. So the idea that you're going to run guys 30 minutes of stadium stairs is beyond stupid. And this is the Willie Taggart clause here. When he threw his team under the bus for cramping up after the first game because they weren't drinking enough water like he told them to or something. Muscle cramps have nothing to do with Gatorade, bananas, pickled juice, or conditioning. Muscle cramps are because you have practiced in a moderate third gear type of manner all for the entire preseason. No matter how hot it was, you never cramped. And then you got into a game and went fifth gear. That's what causes cramps. So you need to practice fast and stop conditioning. We want to get to the line 80% in shape and 100% healthy rather than the other way around. I think many football programs, if not most, this is the other way around. I've learned when I really condition myself hard, I feel myself getting slower. This is not strange to me at all, but McCaffrey said this, and of course, Brian Kula is a friend of mine, and he's his trainer, and they didn't do anything for more than 5 seconds ever, did zero conditioning during the entire offseason last year. Another friend of mine, Vince Anderson, one of the best track coaches to ever live, he said the lowest intensity work you do should still look like performance. If it doesn't, it will have a detraining effect. Not only will you not increase your speed, you will literally decrease your speed. And just because you have thoroughbred athletes that can you can work their ass off and they can take it does not mean you should work their ass off. Generic non-specific conditioning will get you beat. By generic non-specific, picture stadium stairs or doing laps or 16 times 110 or all the dumb things that so many programs do. The grind makes it difficult to train your most explosive fibers. Another Christian McCaffrey quote, and this is a no-brainer to me. Any tired athlete, you can only train speed when you're fresh. So if you're tired every damn day, if you've been crushed on a Monday, you're not going to train speed on a Tuesday. Matter of fact, if you squat heavy on Monday, you won't be able to speed train on Wednesday either. Minimum effective dose lacks the grit and manliness of the football culture. I truly believe that many football coaches would rather lose than to be outworked. I 100% believe this, and most football coaches I've talked to over beers, I can get them to actually admit this. Many football coaches that really love the ideas of Feed the Cats say the first time I would lose with 90-minute practices, I would get fired. And maybe they're right. I don't know. This is for Coach Jones. The prototypical football coach was a slow-footed, try-hard, weight room grinder. Now, that's not a negative. I mean, we were all kind of like that. We were all hard workers who kind of liked being pushed. And matter of fact, we didn't like that wide receiver that missed a couple weight room sessions and still scored touchdowns. And so we have a hard time coaching cats. Matter of fact, our favorites are always grinders like we were. Record, rank, and publish is really, really important. Heisenberg said, he was a quantum mechanic guy, you know, and physics. And when they were studying subatomic particles, he said, what we observed is not nature, but it's not nature itself, but nature exposed. In other words, when we observe something, we change what we observe. And I think that's a great coaching thing. We all know that when we turn away, a bad team will not perform very well. You know, because they're not self-driven, they've been pushed. So the first thing you do is you got to have close observation if you want to really improve guys, their work and their speed work. Video is a great tool, not just for finding flaws, but your kids will actually run faster when they're being videoed. Thirdly, we measure their performance, whether it's the distance of a bound or distance of a jump or the time of a 40 or a 10 meter fly. And the fourth thing we can do is compete when we speed train. Now, if you really have it going, you might do all four of these on the same rep. When I got to Plainfield North in 2007, we had three athletes under 4.6 in the 40. The next year we had eight, the next year we had 12, and then we averaged about 25. In 2017, I think we had 32 guys under 4.60, and that was the year we played for the state championship in football. This should be the goal of every off-season football program, to have as many fast guys as possible on your team. Not the best bench pressers, not the best squatters, but you want the fastest team you can possibly get. Coach Dixon started feeding the cats in 2018, and you can see what happened. Now, he's coaching a school of 260 kids. But you can see what happened in 2018, he played for the state championship. This is a cool idea too. You need a free lap outfit to do this, but with a 10 meter fly, you can easily transfer it to miles per hour. You buy wristbands from rapidwristbands.com. And my guys sleep in these things. They will absolutely love them. And instead of a 1.02 in the 10 meter fly, 22 miles an hour is much more tangible to an athlete. Stuff like this happens. I was this boy's freshman football coach. He never played 1 second in an A game. He was the 46th fastest guy on my freshman team. I was 63 guys. He was one of the reasons why he never got to play. So he was so damn slow. His dad made him go out for track. He ran track 4 years for me. He trained in the winter with me all 4 years, and he got much faster. If you don't have data in your program, then you don't know where you've been and you don't know where you're going. And now he's a really good running back for Northern Iowa with great speed numbers. Very proud of this kid. Now, this guy will either be the first or the second, a little bit heavier than the normal tackle. Last year, the typical first round tackle weighed 312, but he was the number one fastest 40 guy in the draft. And too many times, especially in high school, we just want fat kids to get fatter. We do a real disservice by not sprint training them, not trying to turn them into a big cat. If the NFL believes that among the offensive tackles at the combine, the guy you want to pick is the fastest guy, it must mean something. For one thing, slow does not age well at all. Now, if you're not of typical size, this guy was Nate Herbig. He left Stanford early last year so that he thought he'd probably be a number one draft pick or first round draft pick. But he was a little short, 6'3". He was a little fat, 334, and he ran a 5.41. No matter how good you are, if you run a 5.41, you will not get drafted. And he didn't. Anything more than 5 seconds is not speed work. Something to remember. Now for my sayings, you do less and achieve more. As soon as you say I'm going to practice half as long, you will improve your effectiveness of practice by a factor of 2. Charlie Francis said, athletes should never be sore from training. I really think what he meant was you should never intentionally try to get kids sore. But of course, the weight room believes no pain, no gain. Tired is the enemy, not the goal. Any fool can get another fool tired. Most football coaches are fools. Never let today ruin tomorrow. That's something that football coaches don't understand. If they don't get as much out of the guy as possible, then somehow they failed that guy. Most football coaches want to go in every direction. They try to get too many things done. They fail to prioritize into what really matters. In speed training, you got to put all of your energy into the same direction. You can't be saying endurance one day, speed the next, strength the next. You've got to make a commitment to speed. So I'll go through these quickly. This is the first one's huge. Moderate exercise never leads to high performance. Remember that almost all practice situations, it is moderate exercise. Bill Bowerman said that moderate exercise never leads to world records. And it's the same thing in any sport. You've got to find ways to get a couple good practices every week. Sprinting should replace running. Never let today ruin tomorrow. Never burn the stake. You've seen this. Race horses, not workhorses. We were all turned into workhorses by archaic coaching, but that archaic coaching is continuing to this day. You saw this. You get aerobically fit by crowding together anaerobic work. That's why Christian McCaffrey, even though he did zero conditioning for 6 months, he still won the conditioning test for the Carolina Panthers. It's because counterintuitively, you get in damn good shape by crowding together intense work. Remember, if you do aerobic focused stuff, you're going to get slow. You eliminate conditioning. You practice fast and intense, not long and hard. I'd say most football coaches are long and hard guys. You need to find the 20% that really matters and then get rid of everything else and then go big on what really matters. And you might want to read the book, Essentialism. Do less, achieve more. And then this is huge. The most important thing has nothing to do with what you practice. The most important thing is your preparation to do those things. If you have not rested, recovered, and slept, you will never be able to train speed. And you will never have good practices. So the foundation of your program should not be hard work. It should be rest, recovery, and sleep, taking care of your guys. That's it. I went about 1 minute over.
You're all good, Coach. Great stuff, Tony. We appreciate you coming on. And that presentation, I've probably seen that same thing a dozen times now. It never gets old.